Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning, fellow members of the fund. Welcome to the third annual members' meeting. Ladies and gentlemen, it's been a wonderful year down the road. The same day last year, we had an amazing annual members' meeting, the second annual members' meeting. And over 360 days later, we are back here to celebrate a year of great achievements. Ladies and gentlemen, it's now common sense, and all of us now know that not long ago, about a couple of days ago, in fact, the NSSF did announce a 13% interest to savers. Really, that we as members deserve a round of applause for the team at NSSF. I also want to mention this, and this is important because I'm sure not so long ago, the fund did start registering or having on its books people I can describe as our Generation Y, or as many want to describe them now, as the millennials. Right? So to kick off this in a way the millennials would understand, because we have a hashtag today we want you to get trending, is NSSF, our hashtag, NSSFAMM15. NSSFAMM15, of course, standing for NSSF Annual Members Meeting 2015, so 15. And to start us off, I want to ask the MD, because he's not aware of this. So Richard, please come. And I do hope your phone has some battery. You're going to take a selfie. And I just want to make sure your selfie, if you can have some lights in the hall, his selfie has to include all of us. So he has to do it from around here. So lights, anyone in charge of our lights in the hall, can we have lights? We want to see that all of us are in his selfie. So Richard, you'll find a way here. And have every one of us in the back, and I'll try and run at the back to make sure I'm in this picture. All right, lights, anyone with our lights, anybody? Full lights? Well, he wanted to start.
Oh God, not that many.
That spotlight, can you move the spotlight? Okay. Move the spotlight because, fantastic. Okay, try again, Richard.
In, sure.
Okay, and the others?
Yeah. I'm not in. Alright, there we are. I need a stick. Alright, there we are.
Awesome. So please tweet. Please tweet this. And let's have mobile app is because you can easily check on your balance or your statement on your phone. So you really just need your password and access to NSSF Go, and you're able to access your information on the go on your phone. But it also allows you to view your NSSF statement, you call NSSF helpline numbers directly, send an SMS to receive your NSSF balance, and project future NSSF balances based on different interest rates. So that's the reason, and much more, you need to have NSSF Go on your phone. So if you don't, please go to Google Play Store right now and download NSSF Go. And I'm sure all of us here are members. That's the reason we are here for this annual members meeting. All right, so ladies and gentlemen, I want to invite the Auditor General himself, John Mwanga, to make his presentation, but of course, verify our numbers before we begin. John.
Thank you, MC. Good morning, everybody. All protocol observed. It gives me great pleasure this morning to present to you the report of the Auditor General on the financial statements of the National Social Security Fund for the year ended 30th June 2015. The Right Honourable Speaker of Parliament, I have audited the financial statements of National Social Security Fund which comprise the statement of net assets available for benefits as at 30th of June 2015. The statements of changes in net assets available for benefits and changes in members' funds and reserves and cash flows for the year then ended, and notes comprising a summary of significant accounting policies and other explanatory information as set out on pages 11 to page 73. Director's responsibility for the financial statements. The fund's directors are responsible for the preparation and fair presentation of these financial statements in accordance with international financial reporting standards and the requirements of the Uganda National Social Security Fund Act, CAP 222, and for such internal controls as management determines is necessary to enable the preparation of financial statements that are free from material misstatement, whether due to fraud or due to error. Auditor's responsibility. My responsibility, as required by Article 163 of the Constitution of the Republic of Uganda and Sections 13 and 19 of the National Audit Act 2008, is to audit and express an opinion on these statements based on my audit. I conducted the audit in accordance with international standards on auditing. Those standards require that I comply with the ethical requirements and plan and perform the audit to obtain reasonable assurance whether the financial statements are free from material misstatement. An audit involves performing procedures to obtain audit evidence about the amounts and disclosures in the financial statements. The procedures selected depend on the auditor's judgment, including the assessment of the risks of material misstatement of financial statements, whether due to fraud or to error. In making those risk assessments, the auditor considers internal controls relevant to the entity's preparation and fair presentation of financial statements in order to design audit procedures that are appropriate in the circumstances, but not for the purpose of expressing an opinion on the effectiveness of the entity's internal control. An audit also includes evaluating the appropriateness of accounting policies used and the reasonableness of accounting estimates made by management, as well as evaluating the overall presentation of the financial statements. I believe that the audit evidence obtained is sufficient and appropriate to provide a basis for my opinion, and the opinion is as follows. In my opinion, the accompanying financial statements present fairly in all material respects the financial position of the National Social Security Fund as at 30th of June 2015 and its financial performance and its cash flows for the year then ended in accordance with international financial reporting standards and the requirements of the National Social Security Fund Act, CAP 222. Emphasis of matter. Without qualifying my opinion, I draw attention to note 35B in the financial statements, which indicates that the fund is challenging the basis on which the Uganda Revenue Authority disallowed certain expenses in calculating the company's tax assessment for the year ended 30th of June 2014. The note also indicates the directors have not recognized any provision for the liability of Uganda shillings 84.4 billion to the URA. As management believes that the tax treatment adopted by NSSF is in accordance with the provisions of sections 22 subsection 1A and section 25 of the Income Tax Act. Guidance provided by URA in 2001 allowed for the deduction of these expenses. The note gives details of the court case and explains the directors have disclosed a contingent liability as the ultimate outcome of the case cannot presently be determined. Signed on 20th of October 2015, Auditor General John Mwanga. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Another round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. This confirms our numbers are authentic, and John, thank you and your team for just doing that. Ladies and gentlemen, again, as I mentioned, we have a hashtag, NSSFAMM15. I want to mention that Richard did tweet our selfie, and his handle, if you're on Twitter, is RPBYARU, RPBYARU. So if you're on Twitter, please look him up, follow him. Again, let's add some numbers on his Twitter account. Follow him and also retweet. But also we have the NSSF handle. Please do also follow us on our handle and, of course, our Facebook page. All right, let's do this. And before I introduce our next speaker, I wanted to mention that in your pamphlet, in your folder before you, there is a feedback form. There's an annual members feedback form. I would really want to request that you get a copy that is with you on your pamphlet.
Good morning. Good morning. You know, I usually start by saying, I used to be a school primary teacher. There's something good about being a primary school teacher. When you walk in and you say good morning, everybody says, no, morning, sir. Now, some of you are pretending you skip primary school. Morrison mentioned something that was a bit of an oxymoron. He said that, let's have fun, let's have excitement. But he forgot that, no, I'm an accountant, Richard is an accountant, the other gentleman is an accountant, and we deal with numbers. And if you really want to sweat out that excitement, you really have to pray real hard for all of us so we can have some fun. But I'm going to present the financial performance of the fund, taking the examples from the Auditor General's report to just see how your fund performed. And following just the compliance, the trajectory of growth that we've had over the last 4 years, the fund has performed very well. Compliance levels improved, and what that did is led to contributions. We got contributions going from 622 billion to 688 billion shillings. And if you look at the growth, what that graph shows, from the year 2011, 2015, the growth has more than doubled in your fund. The most amazing thing is, this growth has occurred without NSF taking anybody to jail. And usually there's a rationale, people say, but how come the fund has grown that well and that quickly? Two things. One, the fund adopted what we call relationship management. Basically, coming to the employers and employees and explaining to them that, you know, this is your savings. It is not the government's, it is your savings. And over time, employees began going to employers saying, listen, you need to make sure that you send my money to employers. Let me give you stats that are very interesting. Between 2014 and 2015, about 100,000 members registered to join NSSF, 100,000 members. The number of employers who registered to be employed was about 2,000 employers registered to join NSSF, which means people realize that this money is your money. It's not the government, it's not NSSF money, it is you as a member in that case. So our growth has really gone further. And if you look at what it did to our asset, we moved from 4.4 trillion shillings last year to 5.6 trillion shillings this year. Not billion, trillion. It is easier to go from 1 million to 2 million. It's very hard to get from 4.4 trillion to 5.6 trillion. And that's because you, as members, have trusted NSF with your savings. The most amazing thing with this is, against that asset base of 5.6 trillion shillings, there is about 5.2 trillion shillings of member liabilities. I usually tell people that if we close NSSF today, we would pay all our members. It's what's called a fully funded fund. We would pay all our members. Now, we would pay about 80% of our members within 90 days. The rest of the members, the 20%, may take us 1 year because we have to liquidate the real estate that we have. But all members would be paid their money. And their money consists of the following. What you contributed as a member, what your employer contributed for you, and what NSF has contributed all those years. That is what's called your money. So against 5.6 trillion shillings in assets, there's a 5.2 trillion shilling claim from member funds. Now, these funds are invested in different classes. We'll just talk briefly about them. We have what we call three classes of investments: fixed income securities, We had 4.2 trillion shillings in that as end of the year. That's about 76% of the portfolio of assets. We had in the stocks or securities or equities, we had 902 billion shillings. That's about 17% of the assets, of the investment assets we have. And then real estate is 7%. Interestingly enough, when you add up these numbers, that come up to about 5.5 trillion shillings against an asset base of 5.6 trillion shillings, which means most of the assets that the fund holds are actually earning some income. We don't hold idle assets. 5.5 trillion shillings is what we call investment assets against total assets of 5.6 trillion shillings. So we've done quite well in that area. If you look on the side of the income tells you an amazing story. Last year, our total income came to 801 billion shillings. 801 billion shillings. That's up from 596 billion. If you look at the difference, that's 205 billion shillings. Keep that number in mind because you'll see how that number is very important. That we earned more by 205 billion shillings last year. And that money came from, we had interest income, many of you, the interest rates that rose up, we kind of took advantage of that. Our interest went up to 539 billion. Dividend, for some of you who may DFCU, Safaricom, went up to 34 billion shillings. Then we had other income. Many of you know the our shilling depreciated, but because we have some of our assets and investments are in places like Kenya, Tanzania, and Rwanda, and their currency did not depreciate as fast as ours, we had foreign exchange gains in the process. And that was really incredible for us. What happens is, remember I told you, think about the number I told you about, the 205 billion shillings. This graph, I'm not sure if you will be able to see it very well, but revenues grew by 205 billion shillings. Our costs to operate the entire fund, and I'm talking about total costs. When I talk about total costs, it includes all salaries, all provisioning, all depreciation, whatever you want to call, we've thrown it there, went up from 67 billion shillings to 69 billion shillings. Revenues grew by 205 billion shillings. Costs grew up by 2 billion shillings. That's called good value. In the financial world, we call that, it's called positive jaws. Positive jaws refers to when the rate of revenue, the rate of growth of revenues exceeds the rate of growth of your costs. Any company, and I've been a CEO for a number of companies, would love to have that, when your revenue growth exceeds your cost growth. So for 2 billion shillings more we spent, we earn 205 billion shillings more, and that is incredible for that matter. If you compare us with the banking industry, and most people say, don't compare NSF to it. NSF is not a bank. Don't compare it to a bank. But the closest thing we can compare ourselves to in this country are the banks. There is a ratio called cost-income ratio. Basically, you look at your total income, look at your total cost, you divide the two. How much of your revenues are going to cover your overhead? That's called cost-income ratio. When you look at our cost-income ratio at the fund, it's 13%. When you look at the banking industry, in general, 76%. If you look across our peers, NSSF Kenya, NSSF Tanzania, they're in their 50s, while we are 13%. Globally, there is a ratio that is used to measure efficiency. It's called cost of administration. You take your costs divided by your assets. For a size, our fund, which is about $1.7 billion globally, that target is about 2%. That's the cost of administration. We are at 1.3%. It tells the efficiency that have come through in that process. The interest that we declared was not just derived from out of the blue, but about in 2012, the fund made a determined decision and it guides exactly what we do, that for our members to preserve their money, we must offer them what's called a real return, an interest rate that's above inflation. With us, we even went back further and we said, no, we are going to use 10-year inflation because we are long-term investments. Last year, the 10-year average inflation was 8.23%. We add on that 2%, that's 10.23%. So when we began the year, that was our target. All our activities were geared towards that. The investment department was told, you have to deliver a return that allows us to give members at least 10.23%. As you know, we gave 13%, did much better than expected. And that is high value. Now, if you remember the end of last year, end of June, the inflation rate was about 6%, which means we actually gave 7% above that year's inflation. The 10-year inflation was 8.23%, which means we gave 4.9% above inflation, which is a real return to our members. And that is critical because that means that at a minimum, we are preserving the value of your funds. Now, if you look at our earnings, this is how we distributed it. On average, our total earnings that the investment plan we got was about 16%. That's if you look at that as if you look at if you placed it and you look at our asset value, how much we earn, it's about 16%. This is how we use that 16%. We covered our expenses using 1.3%. We gave the members back 13%. Then we transferred 1.7% to the reserves, which was a very prudent thing to do in that process. Now, I talk a little bit about this. A lot of people have said, well, NSF doesn't pay. And the answer is the data does not support that because last year we paid 166 billion. The end of the year, we had gone up to 186 billion shillings. That was actual numbers we gave. The number of beneficiaries who got this money was about 13,000 last year. Right now, we are running, our projection is by the end of this year, it's about 15,000 Ugandans who are benefiting from the benefits that they do have. And so some people say, well, okay, you guys pay, but you only wait for me to die, then you pay. Now, you know, NSF pays in six. By law, we cannot pay six benefits. One is called survivor. Survivor is only paid to beneficiaries. That means the member has died. Last year, only 3% of the 186 billion was paid to beneficiaries, which means 97% was paid to members who are alive. So for some of you are here, and you think, I'm not going to get my money. I'm going to die soon. Well, let me tell you, I have some news for you. 97% of the chances you are going to have that money. So we make sure that you save with NSSF, because that's critical. Now, I'm going to say, yeah, but the problem is you guys take too long. And I'll tell you something true. In 2010, we used to take 105 days. By the end of last year, we are down to 8 days. And as the MD is going to tell you what the number we are targeting for, so we're actually paying more within a very short time. I talked a little about the surplus. In 2010, we had a deficit. The deficit had actually decreased by 14 billion shillings at the end of the year. By this year, remember we transferred 1.7 billion shillings, 1.7% to reserves. This year, that reserve is 292 billion shillings. Why is it important to have a reserve? There are going to be years when things are lean. There are going to be years when things are rough. You need to have an egg basket that you can actually tap into so that the fund as a whole remains viable in terms of what it does. If you look at our staff, I kind of like this, the last one here. The reason why when you go to a branch you see so much happiness is because the staff actually have bought into the idea and the staff are serving you much more. We do a staff survey across, and they go and rate us as department heads, they rate everybody, and the question is, how well are we doing? And our satisfaction rate as a staff has gone to 84%, which is incredible. I want to read this letter. The point here is, the effort we are making is actually paying off. And for some of you who can read, this is just a letter that came on October the 8th, and guess what the guy said? The guy said, thank you guys, you've done a very wonderful job. We do twice a year, we do customer satisfaction survey, and guess what is at 84% by the end of 2015. Our target is to get that 90% or 95% because we think even 1% customer who is not happy is not good for us. In the legal and regulatory environment, we have the license from UBRA, we have for fund managers, we have for custodians who are banks. The LIB bill that has been talked about, people are asking us about that, that's in parliament. Now guys, Uganda, let me tell you something. Many of us know who our members of parliament are. Now, some of you say, well, I didn't vote. Then don't complain. If you didn't vote, that's your problem. But if you voted, you have a member of parliament, and you have a say. If you do not talk to that member of parliament about what you want, you'll have a problem. And I'm going to give you an example. I'm from Tororo. My member of parliament is Honorable Kanya. I don't know whether he's here. One day we meet in the village, and I tell Honorable, this little bill here, I have some problems with it. You need to make sure that some of these things are changed. This was on a Sunday. The next day, on the way, Kanya stands in the member of parliament and said, my constituency does not like this bill. Now, I don't know how many people he spoke to between 4 p.m. on Sunday and Monday morning, but suddenly I am his constituency. Ugandans, let's learn to advocate. Let's learn to go to our members of parliament and raise those issues that affect us. We keep too quiet, and sometimes we're the only voice that can bring rationality to that. So whatever that we need, we will actually have to that. So our commitment to NSF is this. We will give you those returns. We will provide you with prudent investments, Reasonable return is accessibility and value adding benefits. Thank you and God bless you all.
Thank you, Patrick. As members, I am actually shocked that a couple of us were clapping after Patrick's presentation. Clearly, this is a great performance. So a better hand clap, Patrick deserves, and the fun. I know almost all of us here, not just being members of the fund, also have bank accounts, really. So I don't know any of you who are getting more than 13% on your savings account. Anyone? And it's tax-free. Anyone? So really, we can do better. When Patrick makes a presentation like this, we should be excited. Two things. One, he's told us we are very healthy. Two, he's actually told us we are ready for competition. I am happy where my money is. And I must say, it is time for me now to decide who of us here has been at the fund longest. So I want to do a random survey. Anyone who's been serving with the fund for 1 year, raise your hand. Just for 1 year. Hands, 1 year or more? 1 year? Just 1 year. I want to see everyone. I'm sure all of us have done 1 year. Okay, 5 years. 5 years, show of hands. Clearly, again, majority. 10 years. 15 years, 20 years, and I'm not saying you're 20 years old. I'm saying you've been serving with the fund for 20 years, which means the average age you should be at is about 42 years old. Okay, 20 years, hands up. Now that is when the numbers reduce. 25 years. Okay, now this gets interesting. 30 years. Anyone here? 30 years serving with the fund? Please stand, ma'am. Please stand. Please stand. 30 years. Please stand. Is that? Okay. Oh, I thought it was someone else. Please stand. Anyone better than her? Because 30. Keith, I thought. Oh, Sorry, Keith. I thought you serve with the fund. You have a pension. Anyone more than 30 years? Really, a round of applause for our winner this morning. So, Richard, in your presentation, clearly, you'll be looking at that woman. That is the woman you should be looking at, because the rest of us are just startups. Okay. I want to request again the Uganda National Contemporary Ballet Group to come and entertain us. Thank you.
Morning. Morning. Don't have the sound. Sound. Sound, sound, sound. I know it's on. It's rebelled. Ah, great. All right. Thank you so much, Maurice. Our members, our stakeholders, my boss, the Minister of Finance, represented by Keith, my board chairman, John, from the Auditor General's office, colleagues from the office, ladies, gentlemen. I know that Patrick made a great presentation about our current performance, but guess what? Our current performance counts for nothing, because you already have the interest, 13%, and we need to look up, we need to talk about the future, because the future is really what matters. He sort of alluded to you that the future is going to be a little bit different. There's a law in Parliament which is certainly going to open the market in whatever form it takes, and we need to be aware of such a new development. But we also need to be aware that you have a great companion, which is the NSSF. So I'd like to share with you our plan over the next couple of years. It's probably in the next 10 years. There's a lot that will happen during those 10 years, but let me see if I can capture your attention and also share with you some of the dreams and hopes and aspirations we've got so that we can make you the pensioner that you'd like to be whenever you retire. So, the foundation has already been laid for us. At the moment, we already happen to be a very well performing fund. We've recently been recognized, even the whole of Africa, as a pension provider of sorts. The growth over the last 5-6 years has been phenomenal, and we've been able to use that financial muscle to be able to negotiate good transactions for our members and therefore our returns. Today, we are the largest pension fund in East Africa, so we believe that with this financial muscle, with this phenomenal growth, a foundation has clearly been laid for us to be able to progress to continuously provide you with the service you require. Our objective out of all this is to be the social security provider of choice. As you can see, we clearly identify the fact that there will be choice for you, but would like you to make sure that that choice is us. And that presumably starts with you as a member. We would like you to make that choice when the time comes. To stay there, we'll try and do everything within our means to ensure that you continue to get the customer experience that you need. That customer experience will not just be the best, it will be legendary. Patrick mentioned that we do a customer survey, both internally for our members of staff and externally for our members of the fund. And we've established that currently our ratings are in the region of 80%. So that's what we will provide. Secondly, they say they want good service that is timely, that is accessible, and our promise is to ensure that they have that service through various channels, which I'll talk about, and we'll also strengthen our relationship management model. I think Patrick mentioned it. 5 years ago, when I got into the fund, we used to carry a stick around and go around knocking at employers' homes and offices, basically trying to knock them into paying their NSSF. We've changed the tactics. We've got to manage the relationship, and that's really worked wonders for us. We'll continue to strengthen that, and we believe that that's the only way we can keep the customers happy and the employers happy. Thirdly, they wanted us to be involved in their lives. They wanted us to be involved in their entire life cycle. And what we are promising is that we will develop products, when the law allows, that caters for their entire social security needs. And I'll talk a little bit about that going forward. So how are we going to achieve this? We are going to do this using four pillars. The first one is our deep financial position. The second one is we'll innovate to become relevant to our customers through innovation. Hopefully we can come up with products that are relevant, channels that we can distribute through. And thirdly, we need to ensure that our PE will agree minimum specs for land that they actually own quickly. We will guarantee that if they provide it to us in a certain timeline, we will be able to then pay them for the product once it's available on the market. So once those houses are built, NSSF will buy them and then sell them to our members because we have a ready market. And working with one or two of our banks, certainly the bank that we own, our housing finance bank, we'll be able to also offer mortgages to our members so that they can buy their houses. We've been looking at this quite well. We've already gone to market, and we've actually established there a couple of local developers who are willing to come with us and share with us this journey. What will this do? Open up the marketing space, create demand, and also provide the supply that is needed, but in a manner that's also structured. Because one of the things that you know is that our housing tends to be unstructured because of the way we fund it. So we think that if we can fund it, and we're doing it as a pilot, we're putting in initially 40 billion shillings, we'll see how that gets to us, and depending on the demand, we'll increase our exposure into that particular asset class. The other areas we'd like to look at is our regional strategy, and that's going out into the region, looking for investments that give us a good return. Now, I hear a lot of people say, what about Uganda? We're going to talk about Uganda. We would like to invest also in infrastructure. We know that the government is working through some structures, some financial products, which will enable us to invest in infrastructure. And a lot of people have said, why don't you get involved in infrastructure now? Because there aren't structures. We need financial structures. We are a financial institution. We need to invest in financial products. And therefore, the government needs to structure those ones so a road turns into a financial product which we can invest in. Otherwise, investing in a road, there's no cash flow, as you know, in a road. So we need that financial transaction. This is the one which we think will help us in Uganda. We would like to set up a private equity fund, and this fund will target SMEs that are run well, that have a good market, that have a good product, that have good cash flows, that have good corporate governance, and that are ready for us to get involved in equity, but also exit through the stock exchange. So they must give us a commitment that within a couple of years, this company will be on the stock exchange for us to be able to get involved. So it is an opportunity for anybody out there who's got a well-run business for us to partner with ourselves. And we'll go in as private equity with a view to exit through the stock exchange. What it does is, obviously, it improves the corporate governance structure of our companies, but more importantly, there will be a lot of products on the stock exchange, hopefully. And talking about the stock exchange, we will work with the Capital Markets Authority and the Uganda Stock Exchange in order to create bonds. We've already been involved in one or two bonds, the Kakira Sugar Bond. We got involved in that. And some other asset-based securities, which need to be listed and therefore deepen the financial markets for us and for the benefit of our nation. So, I know this is a very busy slide, but I thought I'd share with you, and those of you who are into numbers, just look at the trend. These numbers show you that from 1993, we as a fund were only in two asset classes, fixed income, sorry for those who are on that side, I'm using the pointer, So you'll notice that we had 70% of our exposure in fixed income and almost 30% in real estate. The problem with this is that, and we had nothing in equities, because at that stage, I believe the stock exchange either was starting or, yeah, was about starting, and we hadn't got those stocks. The problem with this is that the different asset classes behave differently during an economic cycle. So, for example, if fixed income investments are doing well, the stock exchange tends to tank, and equities might do slightly better or slightly worse, or the real estate might do slightly better or slightly worse, again, depending on where the economic cycle is. So in order for us to be able to take advantage of all possibilities within the economic cycle, we need to diversify. So you'll notice that at the bottom, 2015, which is last year, our exposure to fixed income was about 76%, but guess what has happened? We now have taken on a larger portion on equities, 16%, and reduced our real estate to just 7%. Just for the record, our best performing asset is on the equities side, which is the equity investments. Our next performing is on the fixed income, and currently our real estate doesn't perform well. So you can see that if we had maintained this strategy at the very beginning and hadn't diversified, we would have really been in a problem trying to give you a good return. So in conclusion, with our strong base, we are hoping to grow the fund to about 20 billion within the next 10 years, 20 trillion, sorry, within the next 10 years. And we will obviously maintain that minimum that we've told you of 2% about inflation, 10-year inflation as a return. And we will also make sure that our costs are below 1% of the fund, right? Patrick mentioned that last year we'd reduce that to 1.3. So we are giving you an assurance that we'll reduce it below 1% of the assets under management. And that is a commitment so that we can give you a good return. So number two, what are we going to do with our members? Technology is a good thing, so we'll leverage that. We are introducing a smart card probably before the end of this year or early next year. It's also an opportunity for the members. We will be not re-registering, but updating our registration, taking new emails, telephone numbers, and that sort of thing, next of kin, you know, babies and wives and that sort of thing. So we are going to be doing that. But what will this card do for us? This card will enable us to improve on our customer experience. So you'll no longer need to come to a branch. You'll probably use your the ATM that you currently, or the bank that you currently work with. You'll also be able to, in future, to use that card to transact. But the most exciting thing about this card is that you'll be able to build loyalty, all right? So loyalty points are through, obviously, continuing to contribute to NSSF, number one. Number two, contributing a lot to NSSF, and number three, staying with us long. Those loyalty points will be able to get you bonus payments or things that you might want to buy, depending on some of the deals that we'll be able to do with the market. So look forward to that smart card. The other thing we want to do with it is to link it with the national identity card so that it becomes a national identity card substitute. So we're working with the national identity card project. So look out for this smart card coming to you very soon. The other thing we want to do is to improve on our access points. We've already gone the e-channels, so you can go onto your website, you can register there. You can actually even register for your benefit on the website. But we are taking it a little bit notch higher. We are bringing in kiosks, so we'll have our own kiosks apart from those that are provided through by the bank, third party. And we are going to really, really drive this whole e-thing with our customers. Number three is quite exciting for us. We are building a couple of partnerships. The first one that's obvious is with the Uganda Revenue Authority. So we want the Uganda Revenue Authority to collect for us, and we'll be building other relationships for people who will be able to collect for us. We already have an agency arrangement with some of the, say, the Gombolas where they aren't good infrastructure. So we'll try and build on that and make sure that our customers can have a point of contact even if we do not have a physical presence ourselves. Part of our product development, again for our customer, is to take through that journey with our consumer. We know that when our members join us, they do not have a problem of age. Their biggest problem at that stage is probably health. You know, they might get sick. They might require some money for their education, for the kids, for themselves. Or they might even require a business loan. So can we find products that will be able to do that in the short term? We know that in the medium term, the biggest challenge becomes housing. Can we provide a product that will help them with their housing during that period? And finally, we know that in the long term, they'll need to be in retirement, and therefore, can we provide them with a retirement product? So the new law, fortunately, will allow us to do that, and we are hoping that when that comes into place, we'll be able to develop those products that will then become suitable for our members. So quite excited, again, about product development and the future. Number three, if you are keeping count, is our processes. Again, leveraging on technology, we are putting in a new system. That should come on board in the next 1.5 years. That system will enable us to process your benefits. You remember the figure that Patrick said that we'd got to 8 days turnaround time for our benefits today. Our target for this year is 6 days. We believe that by the end of this strategic period, we'll definitely be able to pay you within 48 hours. And that's a maximum of 2 days. Obviously, there will be some places where we can actually pay instantly. But more specifically for our consumers as well, the employer, we need to ensure that they have a portal in which to be able to pay in the money. One of our biggest challenges has been data, and the reason we've had data issues is because of the manual process that we've inherited over the long period. We've managed to automate it. Now we're putting in a new portal, which will mean that it will force every single employer who contributes to NSSF to be able to pay their money into the bank, upload that schedule, and that schedule will be uploaded into our systems, you know, straight through without any human intervention. That should reduce the errors, and that should then mean that when the member retires, all their benefits will be reflected on their statement, and therefore they can be paid in that record time of 2 days that I mentioned. And finally, we need to deal with our staff. I mentioned to you that in order for us to be able to generate a good experience for our customers, we need to ensure that our staff are absolutely delighted. So one of the things we need to do is to ensure that every single member of our staff, at least 80%, 85%, have a professional certification in whatever area that they are dealing with, right? So we've embarked on that journey. It's a hard journey, but it means that we are creating a team of professionals, two professionals who will be able to give you a professional service. The second thing is obviously to do with culture, and we've been driving that through performance. We've already introduced the balanced scorecard, which I'm sure is a tool that is known, very well known, and rewarding our staff. We are one of the first public companies, or I would say public companies, government companies, to introduce a bonus scheme, right? We pay a hefty bonus, and our members are really happy with that. But we need to align that to performance, and we've been gradually improving on that. And that's to drive behavior so that they can then make our customers a lot happier than they currently are. And then finally, we are creating a talent pool and a think tank. Again, good for innovation, because we need kids who are bright, who can come up with good ideas, which we can then pass on to our consumers. So if you look at the rating, we are targeting, again, a 90% approval rating from our staff. So in conclusion, a motivated, well-engaged workforce with good processes and a strong financial base means that we can give to our customers a good reason to stay with us. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Richard. Ladies and gentlemen, another round of applause for the MDNSSF Uganda. All right, now you know why, at the beginning, I did insist that the Y generation is now saving with NSSF. Recent statistics to go by indicate that the majority of our young professionals do not want to have personal-to-personal contact. I really, really want to know what will happen in the future. And they have opted for their phones and for anything that comes with technology. So NSSF and Richard, we want to thank you because the smart card will be a smart way for the millennials not to get in touch with the people at the customer care. I really shudder to think about what will happen 10 years down the road when we are interacting with each other. Clearly, there will be no visits. You'll set up a Skype call and everyone in the family will meet for lunch, but all of you will be in your houses having lunch. That's where we are going. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I want to first of all welcome our brand new chairman. And for members of the media, this is a moment for you to get the right picture. We have sometimes a problem when we have the right name and the wrong picture, okay? So today we get to unveil our brand new chairman of NSSF. So allow me welcome Patrick Byabakama to come and make his remarks. He'll then, after that, invite our chief guest to speak. Thank you very much.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I have my remarks written here. I want to welcome the Honorable Minister of Finance, the line minister in charge of NSSF, represented here by the Permanent Secretary, Secretary of the Treasury, Mr. Keith Mwakanizi. You are very much welcome to be our chief guest today. All invited guests and dear members of NSSF, I'm very happy to meet you. Some time back, I was also a member, but I have since got my benefits. And I was reasonably happy with the benefits. Managing Director, NSSF, and all staff of NSSF, the success of the NSSF is very dependent on the oversight and direction that a good board of directors gives. In that regard, I'd like to commend the past boards, and more so, the immediate past board that ran the institution up to 30th June of this year, and was being chaired by our dear friend, the late Ivan Kiyonka. May his soul rest in eternal peace. A lot of the success you have had today was crystallized during his tenure and his team. On behalf of the new board that has just started its work with effect from the 1st of September this year, we are hardly 2 months old, I would like to reaffirm our commitment to to the ideals for which this fund was created, and for those who read our good history, the fund started its work in 1967. And those ideals were to provide the most effective social security to those that we are mandated to cater for within the Act, specifically non-government employees, those in the private sector and various institutions. The board will meet its oversight responsibilities and will support management to achieve its strategic objectives that have been laid out by the MD a few minutes ago. And if I could recap a little, a few of them, we want to build a customer-centric organization. You are the people that matter first, and we must always prioritize your interest. We want to increase social security coverage within the country. And those who read out here and there, you might note that it is a global. Since 2012, the International Labour Organization is promoting more and more social protection for all citizens of member countries. And Uganda, we are one of those. We want to offer competitive returns to members. You've got 13% this year. Maybe we would love it higher. But let me just make a small point of caution that risk and reward go together. If you want a very high interest return, you could easily run the risk of losing some of your capital or investment. So we have to balance that. We want something higher, but it should be very judicious, and your board will be out there to protect you in that area. We want to unlock the stalled investments where we have started. Some work and progress is ongoing. As a new board, we shall want to complete these projects, and if we find some of them are not worth, then put your money, realize your money exit, and go where it pays most. And some of these investments of concern to the new board is the new pension towers you have always had for the last few years. We have that land in Temangalo. A lot has been written about it. And we have a very beautiful site along Entebbe Road in Luboa, where we have more than 500 acres. We want to make it useful to the members. We want to support the effort to harmonize or enact the new legislation that will reduce bottlenecks that hinder NSSF from delivering its mandate. The last act we have on NSSF was 1985. That is about 30 years old. Time keeps moving, and certain areas of business have changed, and we need to look out for those clauses that need review, and our line minister will perhaps help us in this respect to ensure adequate adjustment is made so that we can move faster. You have heard of the new products that NSSF wants to make for members. Life expectancy in Uganda is expected to be around 61 by 2016. And most members get their age benefit at 55. So you get you work hard from 25, 20, and you are saving, given this money and the pay in the last few years of your life might not be very worthwhile. We want to see how we can help you access some of this saving throughout your 30 years or so, saving life like we heard from the lady the other side. It will take us to achieve all this. It will take us effort to work together and to ensure that we meet these noble objectives. And the team that always works on social security is tripartite. We have you, the members, the key people. We have government to ensure we have enabling environment to save and protect our money. And then we have the employers to ensure they channel these savings to the fund. My appeal to the members is that always remember, you hear of NSSF, this is your money. Pay close attention to how we manage your money. Hold us to account. And where we are going wrong, please urgently raise the issues. And where we are doing right, and you've heard these reports, we've been doing right very recently. In the last 5 years, we've done very right. And where we do right, please applaud us. Really applaud us. Then we shall be and get encouraged to do better. After those few remarks, ladies and gentlemen, it is now my pleasure to invite the PS, Secretary of the Treasury, representing the Minister of Finance, to come and address us. Thank you very much.
The Auditor General, Mr. John Mwanga, the NSSF Board Chairman, Mr. Patrick Byamukama, and of course, as a board new members, the NSSF Managing Director, Mr. Richard Byaragaba, the Deputy MD, I think I saw her coming in, Madam Geraldine Sari, CEOs present, esteemed NSSF members, or political observed, ladies and gentlemen. Of course, it's very hard for me to make the remarks which I'm going to make after this excellent performance, which we saw all over here. Results are very clear, as you saw. But I'm here because and I'm rushing because I'm alone in the ministry. As you know, ministers are trying to survive. So they're in the field. So I'm going to deliver this speech and rush to another two or three places where I'm going to open it as a before I settle down in the office. It gives me great pleasure today to preside over the NSSF third annual meeting annual members' meeting. I'd like to take a moment to congratulate Mr. Patrick Byamukama Kabelenge upon his recent appointment as the chairman of NSSF board. Mr. Kabelenge, together with his board members, have all it takes to provide leadership and strategies and strategic direction to esteemed steer NSSF to greater heights. Let me really congratulate them because of one thing. Under the new Uber Act, of which many people opposed us, in fact, some of you, I think, because I know, have been in the kitchen fighting some of the people. The board members are required to go through incredible tests under Uber board before minister appoints them. It's not like in the past where you'd be appointed from political angle. So there are some, of course, who have failed, I suspect. And some will fail, but don't rush to do politicking, because now there is a role to say, why have I failed? You don't fit. This is a fund, to run a fund of this magnitude, which is now I'm told, and I want to congratulate again people here, because I saw it today, I didn't know, that is the biggest now in East Africa. To run it, it's not, you must be well qualified with a record of no fraud at all to run it. So I want to congratulate the board, the new board, and for members who have passed through that rigorous test. I know about it. I know what it went through. So I want to congratulate you very much. I also want to congratulate the fund for winning the African Pension Leadership Initiative of the Year Award 15. Really, this is great. This is a testimony that the fund's performance is not only being recognized in Uganda, but also to the rest of the world. I would like to commend staff and management of the fund for organizing such a forum where the fund gets report to its board members. I'd also like to thank employers for making diligent contribution to the fund that has enabled it to grow from strength to strength. Forums such as the annual members' meeting provided an avenue to ensure accountability and transparency in the fund's investment and its operations. I also want to congratulate the former board and the management for, I think this forum is the third one, and I know that you are in the second challenge, and I will talk about that one. So I want to congratulate you for that. I have noted from the previous reports and presentations that the fund, that the NSF current asset base has grown to 5.8 trillion, equivalent currently now to $1.8 billion, making it the largest pension fund in East Africa. Actually, to put it in a different way, see it. Our total revenue this year is estimated, I think, about 12 billion. And therefore, we are talking about this is half of what the government of Uganda collects in terms of revenue, which I think is great. Given where the fund is coming from, this is commendable and is a result of good leadership and prudent investment strategies that the fund has put in place. On this note, I would like to challenge the Bank of Uganda and other government statutory bodies to come up with innovative financial products, such as infrastructure bonds, which I've seen you are already thinking about, and the municipal bonds, I don't know that one, we shall talk later, that provide a good return on investment, tap into NSSF growing investment portfolio. As the Minister of Finance, Planning and Economic Development Ministry, we are ready to provide you with necessary policy support to ensure that those investments contribute to long-term economic development of our country. I have to say that there was a board and management of NSSF, and I came to them and I said, please, the best business you can do on us is to buy equity in Bujagari. They looked at me as a fool. And nowadays, when I see what we pay with Bujagari, I feel very angered with those guys who refused that offer. Okay, I'll give you, they are available, by the way. You wait. We shall continue to pursue pension sector reforms necessary to provide right policy environments for sector to flourish. The Uganda Retirement Benefits Authority, UBRA, is now fully operational, and we believe that as a sector opens up, NSSF will play a crucial role in the growth of the sector. I was therefore very happy earlier on when you said you are ready for the competition. But as the sector opens up to the new competition, I want to urge the NSF to continue being vigilant in attracting new members while retaining the existing ones. Because I remember the debate of whether open up or not was that those who were opposed to us opening it up. And it was a horrible debate because it has taken us 10 years or so. We are saying that if we open it up, NSSF will die. I'm happy now the mentality is a different mentality. The mentality of management and the board is that you bring them, we shall defeat them. I therefore want to congratulate you for that change of mentality. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank the board and management of NSSF for the effort in providing much needed stewardship and administration of the fund. The rate at which you have grown the fund is commendable. NSSF members should be proud of you. But let me do this. I cannot go, as you know, I normally sometimes want to put some jabs here and there, but that's not my intention today. I always want to come clean because I come from a strong background of born againness. So let me do this. Following up that paragraph which I've just read, I recall when we were called with my minister, myself and my minister, by the His Excellency the President, and said, do you think the current management has done very well? We looked down. My reports which I'm getting, they have done very well. If so, why are you changing the management? No answer. Then he followed it up with the performance table in writing to say, but if these people have achieved these results, unless you have contrary information, why are you changing them? It was, and therefore directing you to reappoint them. I want to congratulate the president for having disagreed with us. I also want to congratulate the management, the board, especially the late chairman. Because we should thank people for their great performance. I will not feel shy on that one. And the management for having bought shares in NSSF in spite of what they went through Parliament, as if they were criminals. Umeme. You saw it is the most performing thing, the equity, when you hear equities, It is those shares and DFCU and whatever and whatever and whatever. I therefore want to congratulate you that you, what you did was correct and support you. Did I see Honorable? Yeah, I have seen my good friend Honorable there. I think it is honest for us to come out and say you were wrong for having. These results are very clear. We were wrong. I think you are also wrong. And I want to make that statement clearly. And there's nobody, even if you hang me, you cannot take away that result. We should reward performers, not all the it's a gimmicking. We should reward performers if we are going to get the country to compete with the rest of the world. I therefore want, without wasting time, much more time, congratulate the late chairman and the board and the management in particular for taking correct decisions and therefore increasing the your savings, you people. I have noted the plans to grow the fund size to 20 trillion by 2025, which is quite commendable. As a government, we shall continue to maintain interest in the fund. We are keen on seeing the fund, the country's national scheme, and largest financial institution continue to remain a major player in the sector and play an even great, bigger role in the economic management development of the country. I am pleased that the fund is recognizing the best employers for the third year running. Unfortunately, I'm rushing, as I told you. I would have wanted to see it. These awards are a testament that as employers, you are not only paying contributions for your employees, but also complying with the laws of Uganda. I really strongly commend you. On this note, let me finally say congratulations to all the winners and better luck to other employers next year. Thank you for listening to me, for God and my country. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Keith, for always being very honest in your discussions. That is Keith, and I've always told people, when Keith is your guest of honor or making a presentation at any function where he is, mostly his off-cuff comments attract more attention than his speech. And that has got him in trouble sometimes. But Keith, thanks for sharing our conversation on the team. I was wondering whether it was just a conversation with the president, but it's our conversation. You leaked our private conversation. So, Keith, thank you very much. Before we continue, there is entertainment. I want to ask the Uganda National Ballet Team, Contemporary Ballet Team, to join us. But we have free Wi-Fi, so if you have a phone, and the reason we are doing this is we want to make our selfie by Richard trend, and so we want you to get tweeting. So free Wi-Fi, Vodafone 4G, if you look up your Wi-Fi options, Vodafone 4G, you should be able to get in. It's free, it's open. So log in and let's find Richard. He's at RP Biaru, and he did tweet a selfie at the beginning of the meeting. We want that retweeted. We are at what, 34 right now? We would want to get to probably 100 before the meeting ends. All right, so can we have our contemporary ballet? Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Uganda National Contemporary Ballet, another round of applause. Ladies and gentlemen, may I invite now the MD Richard and Patrick to take seats at the front. We will move into a Q&A session. And as I mentioned earlier, we will be taking questions from all platforms. We have questions via Skype, we have questions online from social media. We also have questions we'll be taking from the audience. And I'm hoping the oldest member, I'll run to the oldest member, probably the first question, if you do have. If you don't, that is okay. So, again, I need to mention in your pamphlets, ladies and gentlemen, there is a feedback form. If you just joined us, please do fill that feedback form and we'll ask the ushers to pick that shortly. But also, we are using the hashtag NSSFAMM15. NSSFAMM15. So, let's start there. So, I will begin. I'm hoping the microphones are on for Richard and Patrick. So, I'll begin with you, Richard. As the man who's in charge of this, I'll take the first question, and I'm a member. Listening to both of you, Patrick and yourself, with the numbers, these are exciting numbers, right? And when we take a look at your 10-year strategic plan, well, I say, wait a minute, 20 trillion, aren't we being overly ambitious?
Not at
That is yours, Richard, really.
Not at all. 20 trillion, you know, if you look at the growth trajectory that we've gone through, compare the figures to 2000, for example, and 10, our fund was worth 1.8 trillion. So we've tripled, almost tripled the fund now over the last 5 years. If you look at the growth rates, obviously there is the effect of extracting all the juices, if you'd like, out of the business. But we think that there is still a lot of potential. Let me share some numbers with Ugandans, which you may or you may not know. We have a population of 40 million Ugandans. Out of that, 15 million are purported to be healthy and working. And out of those, 2.5 million are in informal employment, whereas the difference of about 12.5 are in informal. Now, of the 2.5 million that are in formal employment, only 1.5 million is registered with NSSF, and 500,000 or thereabouts are with the pension scheme of government. So you've got about between 500 and a million people who are in informal employment who actually don't have a scheme. But if you include the 12.5 million who are in informal, who require pension when they retire, there is a huge potential. So one of the areas we are exploring, as I said, is in the informal sector, trying to get these informal people to deepen so that they can also come on board. Now, if we put those plans into place, there's no reason why we shouldn't hit the 20 trillion mark in the next 10 years.
All right. Richard, I'll stay with you on this because there is something you did present. We looked at your numbers from 1993 to date. Clearly, the majority of your investment is in fixed income. Again, members, I don't know if members feel this, and we asked Geraldine this question last year. Are we being cautious? Too cautious, because you're actually getting more returns from equity, but your biggest investment is in fixed income.
Okay. Again, let's share the numbers. Our return on equity last year was about 35%, give or take. Our return on fixed income was about 18-17%. And our return on real estate was about 2-3%. So obviously, yes, you would like to put all your eggs in the basket of equities. However, look at what's happening this year. Okay, what's happened this year is that the stock exchange is tanking. If you've been following it, it's probably gone down by about 15%, both here and in Kenya. And that's what the market does. You know, when interest rates are going up, the market on equities goes down. right? So you can't afford to have all your eggs in one basket. That's the point. But more specifically, if you're talking about prudence, we need to be sure that our money will come back. The best place where your money will come back, where you have the least risk amount, is lending to government, right? Government will pay. You know, there are very few governments that have actually failed to pay. Obviously, Argentina and Greece comes to mind, but that's about all, right? And their circumstances were very exceptional. So, yes, it is cautious, but we're dealing with pensioners' money. You do not want people to be able to retire and then not have a pension because you put their money in a very risky environment, okay? So, if we go back to all the factors, one, we need to diversify, no doubts about that. Two, we need to make sure that we are in all the sectors based on the different economic cycles. And three, as Patrick said, we need to build the reserve so that in the bad days, we can actually pay our members still a good return. But we can only do that if we make that money, and we've got to be cautious so that we get our money back. So I wouldn't say, in fact, if you look at our, we've got a model which we use to basically work out what is the optimum strategic asset allocation. Our optimum strategic allocation today is 73% for fixed income. It is 21% for equities, and it's about 6 or 7%, depending on the rounding off, for real estate. You'll notice that we are very close to that. At 76%, we're just 6 percentage points above that. We've got a slightly lower allocation to our equities because of the market situation. We need to get more equities on board. There aren't enough stocks here or in Kenya or in Tanzania for us to invest that are safe. And then we need to reduce our exposure actually to real estate. And as you know, that real estate is not performing well. So we are near our objective in terms of target and return, but we need to be cautious because it's pensions.
All right, Patrick, here's where you come in. And he started off telling us about the crisis, financial crisis, and what's happening on the stock exchange, not just here, but internationally.
Yes.
And that's where I want you to pick up from.
Yeah.
Many are saying, look at what's happening in this country, the state of the economy. The shilling has depreciated, what, to 30%, by 30%? And going by the region, we are actually among the worst performers in terms of depreciation and the exchange rate.
Not as worse as Zambia, though.
Yes, of course. The region, I was staying within the East African region. Patrick, this is where we are wondering whether our money is safe, looking at the Financial Times and looking at the current crisis. If we look around what's happened in the corporate world, I mean, a couple of, you know, an airline has left the industry. Just yesterday, we received a statement from a telecom company that's restructuring. Surely it's tough times. Should we feel safe as members?
And you raise an important question. And part of the thing when you're looking at investments is kind of to pick up those things. You may not get it right all the time. But the hard times didn't start yesterday. The hard times have been here in this country since 2010. I mean, when you look at 2011, the inflation rates just went zack. I mean, we were hitting 30% in 2011. And yet, in each of the years after that, the fund has done very well. Part of it is what Richard has said. Even within the equities market, you mix and match so that one industry could go down, but it's made up by another stock you picked up. So there's even a science in how you pick those equities to basically try to mitigate circumstances where one industry can go down and the other will perform one.
The story is going to change.
Exactly. So you do that so that what happens in the overall aspect, you try to mitigate these forces. And then the other thing is you take a long-term view. Uganda is a young country. Uganda may have problems today, but we are growing. We are going to be a better country tomorrow, next year, 2 years, 10 years to come. So when you're doing investments, you cannot take that long-term view. So, okay, what is going to be when Richard presents the 10-year plan? The idea was to look at that. What in 10 years' time will serve our members better? That allows you to ride the little bumps that you may run along the way. And like we say, this fund is strong, this fund is liquid. The very first question you asked, if most of our investments are in equity, fixed income, in treasury bonds, that's protection by itself. And by then, there's no science that you should not be heavily invested in fixed income or treasury bonds. The US government as of the end of last year, had over $3 trillion. 100% of that is invested in U.S. bonds, treasury bonds. So it depends on what you are trying to do. That's how you protect yourself.
In fact, that was the point I was going to make secondly.
Yes.
I can tell you that there are a lot of pension schemes which are 100% exposed to fixed income, right? So fixed income is not a bad asset class. Everybody will tell you that, you know, somebody pays, the government pays. And if you want to be safe, you should go there.
Yeah.
All right. I know we have a question that is standing by from Skype. We'll have that question played for us. And then I'll open this discussion again for our friends and members on social media, plus, of course, members of the audience. All right. Do we have that first question on Skype?
Yes. Good morning, members. Moses Oyoma is my name. I work for NBS Television as the chief sales officer. I have a question. As a member, well, I've had NSSF getting involved into real estate. You have a couple of estates around that you are trying to invest in. But about, as a member, I need to find out, is there a way I can be able to directly benefit from such projects? For instance, using my savings that I do have with you to acquire less an apartment in any of the estates that you are managing or you are working on to basically benefit me and my family directly. I need to know if this is possible, and if so, then I think very happy benefit directly from such projects. Thank you.
I hope you have the question.
Yes, I did. Rounds about, Moses has savings with us. Moses has heard about the projects that we do with the real estate. Can Moses benefit from his savings and also get a property from us? At the moment, the law doesn't allow us, unfortunately, but I think we talked about it. The law will allow us, part of the new bill, will allow us to create products like that. And this is how we envisage it's going to work. If you have some money with us, you will be able to do two things. Either assign 50% of your money to a bank as security, and that bank will be able to then lend you money so that you can then buy a mortgage to get a property. So that's one way that you can use your savings to be able to benefit from the houses that will be available. The second option is actually to do what they call a midterm access. Midterm access will be on two conditions. Either you've saved with the fund for 10 years, or you've saved, or you've reached the age of 45. There again, you will then be able to remove that 30% of the total amount that you have saved, pass it on to a bank, either as a deposit, or to pay entirely the loan, but also benefit from the mortgage from the bank or pay it to the developer so that you can then get that house into your names. So exciting prospects for the future. Unfortunately, the current environment doesn't allow us to do that. And my board chairman mentioned that the law was written in 1985, and you know, these things were not thought about at the time. Times have changed, we've changed. We need to move on. That's why we need the new laws. That's why we need to change the environment so that we can able to deal with our consumers who become more savvy, like the question that came through.
All right, Richard, there is a question on Twitter, and I want to be selfish and mention who it is. It's from the MD of MTV, Agi Conde. And she asks, my wish is for the fund to consider investing, or really making a statement, for the fund to consider investing in the energy sector in Uganda. Is that an area of interest?
Well, the Secretary of the Treasury, the representative of the Minister this morning, said there are a lot of deals. You know, Bujagali was one of the deals that was brought to NSSF at the time and rejected by the management that was there then. The bottom line is, yes, we would love to go into energy, we would love to go into infrastructure, but there must be a deal, there must be a structure, there must be something that that basically puts a financial instrument that we are going to then invest in, but that financial instrument should be linked to the project, okay? As I said in my presentation, if you build a road, let's look at the Entebbe Expressway. Entebbe Expressway will cost, I don't know, $13 million or whatever, $13 billion or whatever it is anyway. I don't know what the figure is, don't quote me. But whatever the figure is, that cost is going into concrete, it's going to tarmac, it's going into all the things they use and the steel and so on and so forth. But how is that road going to then raise the cash flow to be able to pay us back as NSSF if we invest in that, if we take an investment in that project, okay? Somebody at the Ministry of Finance, somebody at the Bank of Uganda, somebody somewhere at the Ministry of Works needs to work out a financial product that we shall then be able to invest so that we are able to get some cash flow coming back to us. So yes, we will love to invest in energy, but we must have a financial transaction, an instrument which we can invest in and that is safe, right? The safeguards must be there. So you must have your corporate governance structure around it. You must have the cash flows, the money being collected from, you know, whether it's a road toll or it's a payment of power, whoever is doing it. So we will do it, but there must be a financial transaction for us to be able to invest.
All right, Patrick, I have to bring you in on compliance. And I noticed compliance is at 77%.
Yes.
I'm sure you and Richard would be happy to have it at 100%.
All right.
And I've seen ideas in the strategy plan to engage partnerships, to get partnerships with agencies like URA.
Yes.
Let's begin there and find out what else are you actually doing to drive this compliance?
Okay.
Other than, of course, rewarding the most compliant who are here today, what is it you are actually doing to increase your muscle?
Let me take it a couple of things. Under there's an undergirding principle to this. My grandfather always say that if a fly is going around a room, you can do two things with that fly. You can get a sword and chase it until you hit it, or you can put honey on a glass, and pretty soon that fly will come to the glass. Now, which one takes more energy? I think the honey works better. So a few years ago, what the fund did, what Richard talked about, relationship management, is basically to begin an education process. We go to companies. Last year, we went to close to 800 companies. People at top management to go and talk to the employees, explain to them, this is not a tax, this is a savings, and that has raised this. And we'll continue to do that. Because when people realize that it's serious savings, let me just tell the members a number here. By law, for each shilling you save, the law requires your employer to put in 2 shillings. Now, if you are any person in business, that means day one you get 100%. Day one. And that's a good deal. Now, as people realize that they're coming to that area, so we're doing a lot of education at this point in time. We're doing the awarding. We're making it easier for them to basically register with NSSF. We go there, talk to them, send the keys to them. Then we're also increasing level of transparency because the more people get to know and trust you, the more they will actually do what. And as we continue to pursue that, that will work. Now, there is also a tool that Richard has also mentioned that we know there are certain employers who are struggling. They're not bad, they're struggling, so you need to relation manage them. But there are those that are actually very bad. So they will take you on. Now, what you're going to find in a few years, in a few months' time, NSSF begin to take more of those employers who think they can get away with it. Because at the end of the day, they are robbing their workers. So you'll see a play between the relationship and the stick.
I don't know if you recall the adverts we run, you know, 3,200 customers are employers are robbing their staff, right? We run those adverts, probably run them again.
And it did work, did it?
Yeah, it worked. We actually got in about 2,000 employers who actually came through. Another 1,000 that were whistleblown on by their employees. So it did work, yeah.
All right, I'm taking questions from the floor, so please feel free, raise your hand. Asha's moving around with the microphone. So if you have a question,
yes,
we have a question. Your name, keep it short.
Yes.
My name is Bill O'Connor from London. I add my voice to those who have congratulated you for your appointment with NMD. Mr. Mokanisi was here this morning and said, congratulated you, the old board and the new board, for the good work. grow on the tree are more healthy than the tree itself. I'm saying this, that if we have said that you are doing very well, if you have said the old world and the new world are doing very well, why do we need Oprah? Is it not a trap? Is it not a parasite?
Why do you need Oprah?
Might allow in weak players, it might allow in people who come in and take your money for free, and so on and so forth. So yes, I think regulation has a purpose, and I think that if you look at it in that spirit, then yes, there is need for regulation. I think there was an issue he raised about the cost of regulation. Now, obviously the framers of the law included in a levy, just for those of you who might not understand why he raised that particular issue. They raised the levy, which basically means that we as NSSF pay a sum of money to the regulator every year based on, is it 0.25% of our total assets under management, okay? Now, the thinking behind it is obviously the regulator needs to exist. Now they are raising the money from the industry. It would have been better if they had raised it from the government, but I think that's a discussion which can be talked about, and whether it's a lot or not. But I think the principle is, and that's why I say I have to be careful, the principle is there should be a regulator. Whether they should impose that fine is really something that you can debate and intellectually. Let's go back to the issue of liberalization. We have come out publicly and said we do not have a problem with liberalizing of the sector. We think that the introduction of other players in the market is a good thing for the industry because it improves on performance, it improves on innovation, it improves on competition, and competition, as you know, has the advantages. Of course, there are disadvantages because you can get in some players who might not play according to the rules. That's why you then need a regulator. So we will support the liberalization. However, we believe, all right, we believe, and I must say this with an emphasis, we believe that the government needs to have a national scheme, right? We can have a private scheme, we can have private schemes which basically are dealing with the rest of the market, with some of the market, but there must be a national scheme, and that national scheme should have at least an amount which is mandated to come to the national scheme, because then government has a pool of funds which they can continue to use, and so on and so forth.
Right. We will take our second question for some of the questions here before I take this guy's question. Alright, I'll begin there. Yes. Keep it short, your name, please.
NSSF has the muscle to construct hostels and lodges for students. Would you like to consider that? Thank you.
Yes.
The quick answer is yes. But do hostels make money? Is there a good corporate governance structure? Are there entrepreneurs who are involved who are honest enough to disclose everything regarding that business? Are they ready to basically come to the stock exchange eventually as an exit for us? Okay. If all those conditions can be met, we will definitely be able to. And I'll say this as a general comment. As Ugandans, we are not good at creating transparent institutions, corporate-wise, right? We don't want to keep our financial statements. We do not want to appoint professionals to our boards. We want to appoint our relatives as cashier and the managing director and the whatever, your wife is whatever.
Yeah.
There is no way NSSF can get involved in that business because we know it will definitely not survive, okay? So we need to create institutions, and the only way we can create those institutions to do good business is making sure that they disclose everything. You know, it's not unknown, I'm sure you know, that companies will have three books of accounts, you know. So, you know, if that sort of business is involved, we won't get involved. So yes, unless it's structured, it's making money, there's a cash flow, there's a good governance structure, and we can enter and exit, we'll definitely. I just want to give an example. We are in the Serena. Serena, we have almost 20% shareholding in the Serena. This Serena you're sitting in, the Serena that's across the road, the Serena that is in Kigo. Why are we in it? They've got a good governance structure. They are transparent. They give us a dividend. And we've gotten involved. Just as an example, all right? When the Aga Khan was coming to invest here, he needed other investors. And we thought it was a good business. So we got involved. So we can get involved in hospitals. We can get involved in hotels. We can get involved in schools. And so long as there is a structure that actually makes sure that our money is safe.
Mm-hmm. All right. I want to take a question around SMEs. Anyone wants to get a question?
Yes.
It had to be. Let's have around SMEs, because Richard's strategic plan is to tap into the SME sector and actually invest in the sector. Yes.
Thank you, Richard. Thank you, Maurice. Richard, I think you're going to need a pen for this one. Picking up.
I'm going to do what, sorry?
Emmanuel Kasule, HR Director, Africa Uganda. So, picking up from what you've just been saying about SMEs, you mentioned in your presentation that SMEs that have good books and whatever, you're going to consider them for financing. However, just like you've said, there are many SMEs that do not have good SOPs, standard operating procedures for modern organizations. So given your 20 trillion project, how do you expect to get to 20 trillion when you're going to get probably three or four SMEs that are well run as per your guidelines? Second question, the investment guidelines in NSSF, the deputy MD Geraldine last time talked about how the process of getting validation from the ministry and all that takes a little bit of time. So if you chance on a project that is going to bring back a big return, and then you have a process that takes about 6 or 7 months to get approval, of course you're going to lose money. The market indices certainly do not and will not support your investment return, especially now, given that the dollar is rising, it's going to 4,500. I think it has to get there before it starts going down again. Next question. Biggest financial institution in East Africa. I'd like you to give a little clarification on that, because Kenya alone, I think their industry portfolio would be able to raise more than what we have right now. So I think if we say the biggest growth in the region, yes, but as far as the financial base is concerned, I would like to take some exception to that. Then, why not an NSSF bank? There are many contributors who contribute a lot of money to this bank, to this institution, but then getting their returns, you mentioned that, yes, legislation needs to be looked at so that, because the times have changed. But in the interim, don't you think it would be a feasible idea to establish or to go into full-time financial institution like an NSSF bank, where contributors, only contributors, can get financial products or services, but using their savings as collateral? Okay, it might be a very good idea. Or you could partner with Housing Finance Bank to do this. You would certainly build a good product portfolio, and the risk would be low. Final question.
Yes.
Financing of real estate for contributors. Many people right now, of course, they would like to get mortgages, or some are already actually mortgaging their own homes, as well as having unsecured loans from their respective banks. How would you program a product that will enable contributors to be able to access that mortgage facility in NSSF while having all these other loans with the other banks? I find a little bit of a problem there, especially with regards to financing. Thank you very much.
All right.
Sorry, it's a mouthful, but try.
All right. It's a mountain of questions, but let me first make a clarification on the numbers. We are the largest pension scheme in East Africa at the moment. That's we are not comparing ourselves to the other financial institutions. We are the largest pension scheme. So if you look at NSSF Kenya, NSSF Tanzania, RSSB Rwanda, and I can't remember the one in Burundi. We are the largest of them. That's what I meant. With regard to, I think you talked about the SMEs, the fact that if we aren't supporting them, how will we increase our collections? I totally agree with you. We need to do something about SMEs, but we cannot do debt, okay? Let me clarify. We cannot do debt at all. The law doesn't allow us to do any debt. So if we are to go into an SME or into an institution like the hostel that that Moses raised earlier on, that engagement, that financial transaction has to go through equity. So it's on the top line, not debt, the bottom line. So that means that we have to take a percentage of that company. That means we've got to be entitled to board members, board membership. That means that we need to be involved in the running of the company. You know, with debt, as you know, if you go to a bank to borrow, the bank does, you know, gives you the money, but they don't get involved in the day-to-day management. They don't appoint board members to your board. We have two, all right? So that's the difference. Now, for us to be able to do that, that's a bigger commitment than actually a loan, right? So that's why banks can issue out all those loans without necessarily taking a lot of due diligence. We have to take a more in-depth due diligence. And I agree with you, as Geraldine mentioned last year, as I mentioned this year, we still have a huge problem with the current law, because all our approval for whatever investment needs to be done in consultation with the Minister of Finance, and that makes us uncompetitive. So one of the issues we've gone to the Minister and said, if we are to go and compete with the rest of the pension schemes that will come into the market, we need to review this law, because it might take me 6 months, it might take me a year. There is a deal that took us 3 years, and hasn't even been done yet, that we haven't been able to get approval for. So we will definitely become uncompetitive. So in that respect, yes, we need to review the laws. I'll then end up on the whole issue around housing, right? And I might have forgotten one or two of the issues that you raised. But the issue of housing, basically put, it is that we will be able to do two things. Either, and when the new law allows, either allow you to take out your money as a lump sum, pay it either to VOP or to a bank for you to be able to then get a house or own a house, or you'll be able to assign at least 50% of whatever money you hold to a bank as collateral. So that improves your credit rating. It also means that the bank can make that decision, and it will then lend you to be able to get that mortgage. Whichever the form is, it still needs the law to be changed. And we think that it will be able to drive the mortgage market, certainly, because that's the intention. And you raise some of the capital or release some of this capital that is currently held in banks. I think I'll also end on, well, I just remember that you also asked about why don't we start a bank. Again, to be able to start a bank, first of all, we do have actually a lot of banks. Just in case you're not aware, or if you check our balance statement, financial statements, we actually have ownership in Bank of Baroda, quite a sizable amount. We have Stanbic Bank, we own quite a size of it. We own DFCU Bank. We own Housing Finance Bank. So we do actually own a couple of banks at the moment. Whether we should start a whole bank ourselves and run it ourselves, I think there are issues there. Because why? What would be the intention? The intention is to try and release our capital. We do release our capital through the banking system. And I think that you cannot blame the NSSF for some of the problems that the banks have gone through. We've certainly provided that liquidity, short-term liquidity, because that's what they use. Long-term liquidity, no, because they are not a long-term lender.
All right, we have a couple of minutes, and so I will ask that we play the second Skype question, and then I will also take a couple of questions from Twitter. So if we have a question on Skype.
Hello there. My name is Edgar Kwesiga, and I'm a creative director at Spire Brand Consultancy and Creative Agency. A while ago, I was employed at a company, and I had an NSSF account, and but later on, I quit. It's been 5 years now. But I earned some money on my own, and my query is, I wanted to find out if it is actually possible for me to get some of my personal earnings and savings and be able to deposit them on my account, on my NSSF account, given the fact that I have no employer who is supposed to revert some money from my earnings to the NSSF. So I need you to tell me whether it's actually possible for me as an individual to deposit, because I have an NSSF account which has some money on it but hasn't been getting some money from the time I resigned from my full-time job. Thank you.
Good question, yeah.
Very good question, Edgar. Yeah, very good question, Edgar. I talked about a voluntary product. There is already a voluntary product. The law allows you to continue to use your account even if you are no longer in formal employment. I believe he's still actually in employment. It's only that his employer perhaps does not meet the minimum five members requirement. So he can continue to contribute voluntarily, and that money will be paid into his account, and he will continue to receive the benefit and also be paid interest.
All right, quickly here, there's something that, you know, someone sent on Twitter and asked, the Temangalo and Simbe housing projects, when is this starting?
Very good question. Let's start off with the more difficult one, that's the Simbe. In Simbe, we don't actually own even. Okay, little bit of history. 2004, 2003, there was a joint venture with a company called Mugoya Construction. The intention was that they would own the land and we would own the money and we would together build and sell through the joint venture. That transaction, as you know, was cancelled by the investigations that were carried out by the IGG, and therefore the assets reverted back to their owners. So their land reverted back to whoever owned it, and the money, well, which money? Reverted back to us, but obviously we didn't get back the money. So what we are is we are in a process, both through arbitration and perhaps through a legal process. We are trying to pursue that land. We believe that we've got a very good chance of at least recovering 49%, which is our share in the joint venture, to be able to recover that land. That will give us at least 400 acres, and we'll then be able to have those acres and actually build something. So there is a process to be able to get that land, to be able to build something. So that's a little bit away. Temangalo is slightly easier. 200, 300 acres. No, actually more than that.
400 acres.
We own most of it. There's quarters in one or two other places, but not that significant. We actually already have a plan. We already have even the technology to be able to do it. And we believe that certainly in this coming year, that starts in 2016, we should be able to have a contractor on site to begin constructing those houses, okay? There will be two big projects running. One will be in Temangalo, and one will be in Lobowa. As you probably notice, Lobowa will be the sort of higher end of the market, and Temangalo will be sort of lower end of the market because of the distance. And we'll come back to the market to tell you what units. In total, they probably would be about between 8,000, and if we can push it up to about 10,000 units.
All All right. This is for you, Patrick. Charles asks, Charles says, 13% is good, but what happened to whistleblowing? Employers still don't come clear. Is that the honey effect? You know, is it something we can look into?
Actually, it is very punitive by law for an employer not to comply. Really punitive. What the law has said that if you do not comply and we find out, you basically have a 10% penalty per month on the balance that owed. There are companies that ended up owing maybe billion shillings in just the principal and the interest. But the penalty is 6 billion shillings. So it's not a good thing for an employer not to comply. It's really dangerous for them. You can shut that business down. What we really appeal for the employers to come forward on their own. Then the MD, depending on what they negotiate, can then look at the penalty phase. So really it's good for them to come forward, so it will help them.
And quickly, someone adds here, they say shift paradigm or paradigm shift and weed yourself from the URA model of wait and capture funds. How many jobs can you create to increase your members? Meaning through your equity and other investments, again, looking at real estate, how much can you create that would bring on board more members for you as a fund?
It would be, the ripple effect would be this. Let's say you are able to get a company today that's maybe generating 20 billion shillings and has all the components that Richard talked about. And we get in there with an equity position and work with that company. In 5 years, it's a 100 billion company. The amount of employment it generates is just incredible. And what we know that in business, and especially in investments, you may get in 10 companies, 5 fail, but 5 become the Madhvanis, the Metas, and so on. The ripple effect is really incredible. So to put a number on what we know is that it would really, really, really improve the employment situation in this country if we make that work.
All right, Richard, again, this you mentioned in your remarks on Serena, your investment in Serena,
yes.
Kampala,
yes.
And the Serena Group here in Uganda. But there is a proposal for the Serena Group in the region. How far has that gone? Because I know there must be a document somewhere, either seated with you or somewhere, on a proposal which could actually make us members richer on investing in the Serena Group, not just Serena Kampala, but now all the Serena hotels in Africa.
Maurice, that's unfair. It's an unfair question. It's not an unfair. Okay, a little bit of background. I told you we own, 20-odd percent in the Serena here. There is a proposal that we should convert those shares into the group shares based in Nairobi. That would give us a bigger coverage, a bigger business, and perhaps a bigger value and evaluation, because the Serena shares in Uganda are not listed on any stock exchange, and therefore they are private equity, whereas the stock exchange in Kenya is listed, and therefore there is a valuation, a public valuation, which has a liquid market, and therefore transactions taking place. That was agreed by the board and sent on to the minister. Unfortunately, we haven't got the response back from the minister, and hopefully we'll get it one of these days.
All right, I'll take one question, because I have 1 minute. So I will look out for where the nearest usher is to a hand that is up. I think there is there. So the gentleman in front of you, yes. Keep it short, very short. We have a minute.
Thank you. You talked about administrative costs and you committed to reduce them to 1%. And you just talked about the UBRA where you pay 0.25%. Now my question is, will that turn to 1.25%? Because I believe that is the cost would be 0.6, is it 7.75%?
No, it's 0.05%.
Yeah. The other thing also is, do we have, I know there is, in terms of
0.025.
Before 55 years, you can get, when you join UNDP, UN agencies, when you're part of the government, are there other options that you can get your money before 55 years other than the ones I've mentioned?
Sorry, the number I should have given you on the levy that the UBRA charges is 0.05%, not 0.25%.
0.025.
So there's a zero before the 25. Otherwise, yeah, you're right, it would increase our cost by 0.25%. But ending up with the question that you asked, which is the benefit of As I said, the new law will allow midterm access, okay, up to 30%. Okay, that's why Patrick said, talk to your member of parliament, because this law has been sitting in parliament since 2011, or yeah, actually 2011. It's 4 years been there, and I'd like to say this: it isn't a sexy law. All right, I don't know if that's the right word, but it isn't a sexy law for them to pass. So they're not too keen on it. They're keen on other things. I'm sure the politics and that sort of thing that gets more attention. So we need to ensure that the parliament actually sit down and look at this law and actually pass it, because there are good things in it. There are some things which we are against, but on a whole, the law is good for the pension sector, because it opens up innovation and allows us to do a lot more things. So those, the things you are saying, will be dealt with in the future.
All right. I know there is a member of parliament here. I can give you a minute, Honorable. Yeah. If you can have a microphone, move to the Honorable member of parliament there, quickly. There's a mic, yes, just behind you.
Thank you. In fact, we are two here. My honorable colleague representing the workers, she's seated in front here. Thank you so much. One, two things. I wish the PS Secretary Fisher was still here, because he had said something about Parliament. My name is Okupa Elijah, Member of Parliament for Kasilo County, Serere District. But I'm also a member of the committee that oversees NSSF. He said we're wrong when we had issues with the Umeme and NSSF. But I wanted to just make a clarification. When Parliament was objecting to the issues of NSF investing in Umeme, it was based on law, based on the rules, because our rules provide that it is sub judice for any public institution to continue to do any work with any company that's being investigated by Parliament. So at that time, Parliament of Uganda was investigating Umeme. So it was at the same time that a decision was taken by the board of NSF at that time to buy or to invest in Umeme. So that was where the argument, the reason was. But also there were also issues which had been raised by Auditor General. You know, Auditor General always just sends us, we shield him, because we are the ones who take up from the issues which are raised by the Auditor General. So it was on those grounds that Parliament was saying, please, could you hold on? Not that it was against NSF investing in Umeme. The other one was, from the reports we had got from URA, Umeme was making losses. So how would we allow NSF to invest in Umeme when it has declared losses for the last 2 years in URA? So those were the critical issues. But finally, on the issue, we are about liberalization. I'm one of those who is opposed to the liberalization of NSF. But this time, I cannot give the full reasons here. But also, I think we confuse ourselves here, because we are saying NSF and Richard and group are doing so well. Then why would we liberalize it if it's doing so well? Thank you.
All right. I think the losses mentioned, Richard, you would want to help us on that, because it was on tax losses, right?
Yeah, I think it's tax losses, yeah.
All right. Okay. I'll take a question or a comment from the former board chair. Christopher, yes, if we can have the mic here.
Those young gentlemen you see there, very, very active people. One is the wizard of figures. Another one is very much what.
So, is what? Is what? Is what?
Can identify them by yourselves. There is something about working with the government. This fund has been around for some time. And I think our first board of 2009 to 11, and then the present and the last one, which ended in May last this year, tried its level best to involve government, to interest government to work hand in hand with NSSF, because we had the money. One time we pointed out that we had 2 trillion shillings which we can give the government, because government is the best debtor. You can't lose with the government. But on that, on those boards, we had representatives from Ministry of Finance, PSS, they were members of that board. But I don't know what went wrong, and we have come out without investing with the government, which is very, very unfortunate, because we've been to Kenya, we've been to Tanzania, we've seen what NSSF has done with the government. You see the university in Tabora, you see the housing estate in Nairobi, in Kenya, you know, those NSSF was involved. But let's put that aside and perhaps pass it over to the new board to make sure that we are involved in the development of our own country before we think of investing outside. Then, Minister of Finance. Minister of Finance has made it very difficult for the fund to operate. In our local language, in the workers' side, we call it as soon as immediately. That is how we almost lost the Omeme thing. Because you have got to go to the minister to have an objection, then you go to the Solicitor General to say whether he has no what for guidance. All those can't work when you are doing business. Business is business, and you have got competitors. So something should be done as soon as immediately, if there is an opportunity. So I think our new board, you better sit down with the minister and explain this one to him, that the minister hinders our work.
Very quickly. Yes. I hope it's lastly. Yes.
Yes. One is bad. Let me first start with the Umeme. There was a thinking that the board had refused the Umeme or blah, blah. No, the board didn't refuse the Umeme, and we are not dealing with the whatever it was, Umeme itself as Umeme, not any other body. And now, on that one, we said that the thing was done quickly because the MD and the managing director at that time, the chairman of the board, did not have time to raise with the whole board. They sent a few emails and took a decision. Now, our objection was, what if that decision was wrong? Fortunately, it happened to be right. But if it was wrong, that is why we say members should be involved and append their signatures to that deal. That was a big deal. But they did not refuse to work, to buy those shares. It should be corrected, that one. Lastly, somebody was talking about NSSF having a bank. Really, why doesn't NSSF take over Housing Finance Bank? We have 50%, I think, am I right?
Mm-hmm.
Shares, 50%. Now, why should we buy that one, you know, start a bank and whatnot when we have already a bank? Why don't we really support this bank if not taking it up completely? I thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Please pass on the microphone to Geraldine, please. Thanks.
Thank you very much. I'm going to spend 2 minutes, and it is really out of reach. My name is Geraldine Salib Sulwa. I'm the Deputy Managing Director of NSSF. I didn't think it would be just for me not to say something. I had someone talking about building hostels. Now, it's going to take me back to the conversation where I want to support my MD on the issue of projects. And this is something we cannot leave this room ignoring. We have got a lot of money at NSSF that we could use as a country. And let's not lose track at any one point on that issue. I could see Paul Bachariza writing an article last week in the newspapers. NSSF can do more. I cannot agree more. I do agree that this fund is a sovereign fund. It is a fund where we can actually benefit as Ugandans if we have the will, the political will, to do so. And I'm looking in the direction of the honorables. That if you can actually enable us and not disable us and create and concentrate and create policies that could actually support this sovereign fund. If someone is going to talk about building accommodation, no, we want to actually build the university, not accommodation. We want to go and build the hospitals because we are social security. That's why you need a national scheme, Ugandans. The national scheme is going to build you the hospital, not by the beds where you're going to sleep with the patients. So we are going to have the bigger conversation, and that's the macro conversations we need to have. And these conversations are going to be had by the big boys. By the big boys, I mean the people in Parliament, the people in the Ministry of Finance, and the people in the Bank of Uganda to do the bonds. And then for us, our jobs as management is to make sure that you're giving us bankable projects where we can account for each penny that we are investing in these big projects. Right now, we do not have those vehicles. That is what the MD was saying, that you have got to have the financial instrument to account for that money. Otherwise, you end up in Simbe. So the concentration should be on creating the bankable projects to monitor the income streams. We have put in money. This is how the money is coming back over the 30 years. So let's not lose that conversation. But we are not going to go and have small conversations of complementary industries. Yet we can have the macroeconomic conversations, and everybody who is supposed to have those conversations in this room. Unfortunately, the ministry is not here. But as we said, we are ready in the energy sector. We are ready in Omeme. We have invested in there. We just need to know to what extent do we actually invest in some of these industries. We do have the vehicles, the things we invest in. So let's go. Then in terms of, there's a person called KCCA. KCCA has actually approached us on so many occasions. They would like to invest NSSF money in infrastructure projects. But guess what? Their law is telling them that they cannot actually borrow 10% of their revenue. They cannot exceed 10% of their revenue. And then back here at NSSF, we are telling them we have the UBRA, which is not allowing us to lend you directly. So we have actually incapacitated ourselves. But for a quick win, these are some of the small things we can remove as legislators in Parliament to actually make this thing move. But if we all just look on, this is what is going to happen. We shall meet here every year and talk about why NSSF is not investing in projects. We can continue to do that for as long as nobody takes action. So please, the people who are responsible, do take the action and make the managers enable. Otherwise, we cannot come to push, but we kindly request that you look into this matter because we are tired of talking about it every year. And then the legislations that are going to enable us to compete should be either uniform for everybody, or if you want us to remain with the legislation of Solicitor General, PPDA, Attorney General, and everybody else, you make us a national scheme, and that is in good faith. And the reason you will want that national scheme is so that you're able to actually carry out the national project. Otherwise, you're also going to disadvantage the country because managers will just be chasing profits without looking at the nationalism of that country. Thank you very much. That's my submission.
Now, members, for me, I am excited that my managers are that passionate. I don't know if you are, so I'm sure we would have done better with clapping for her and her presentation. I really must end this because we are playing within broadcast time, and I don't think NSF is happy to spend more members' airtime or money on TV airtime right now.
So I want to take the questions that were sent to us very quickly here. Richard, someone says, NSSF is investing using members' money, but after paying off the member, this is after the 55 years, how does that member, how can that member continue benefiting from that investment, since he actually did contribute to that investment?
The quick answer is no, because they are no longer members. So, well, let's look at it this way. When you are contributing today, we are investing in an investment. So when you exit, somebody else will now also begin to contribute, and they will take the benefit. So the benefit only accrues to you when you're still investing. But if you want to continue to accrue, you leave your benefit there. That investment will still continue to give you that investment. So you don't have to get to the age of 55 and remove your money. We've got a lot of members who've got to the age of 55 and they said, well, I don't really need this money at this particular stage of my life. They've left it with us for a while, and they can come a little bit later. Therefore, they continue to receive their interest and benefit from the projects that they've invested in.
All right. Patrick, quickly, someone asks, I hold two accounts, which I think should be wrong and illegal. I hold two accounts with NSSF, but one is no longer active, meaning I think the employer created a new account. Is it possible to merge the two accounts?
Yes, and it should be merged. So basically, if we can have his contact details, we'll make sure that's sorted out.
I'll pass this on, because he has also created his, he has an email here.
Okay.
Again, finally, and I'm taking this because, again, you and I are very passionate about sport, Richard. Someone says, and I really want to thank Fred Robert Waswene, who says, you talked about investing in real estate. Can you also look at investing in sports? And here he emphasizes and says, if you had an investment, say, in an international standard stadium, isn't that a good idea? And he's asking, because that could attract some investment.
Very good idea. I don't know, the record is almost broken. I need a structure to invest in that. We can't do it ourselves. We need somebody to do it. We need to join them, you know. And you know how much I love sports, you know. We've actually, part of our corporate social responsibility is we sponsor volleyball, right? We sponsor volleyball from the lowest level up to the highest level, up to the national team. So we are passionate about sponsoring sport. We felt volleyball was our current vehicle. But certainly if there is an investment of this sort, we need a vehicle, a financial vehicle which we can invest in.
All right, we must end it here. So, ladies and gentlemen, please stand for me, Patrick and Richard. We've done an awesome job. You may take your seats. Again, as I mentioned, and if you're just following the conversation and you're joining us online and on screen, our hashtag is NSSFAMM15. Keep your questions coming, keep your comments coming, because the team, Richard and the team at NSSF, will be taking those questions, and of course we'll get back to you. I also want to mention that we had a selfie by Richard. The last time I checked, we had 40 retreats. I really want us to push it to 100, and we have about 10 minutes to conclude this business. I hope we'll get there. All right. Now, finally, I want to welcome Barbara. Barbara, please come. Barbara Limi, who will take us through the rationale of our awards this morning.
General, Mr. John Mwanga, the Chairman NSSF Board, Mr. Patrick Yabakama, and NSSF Board members present, our Managing Director NSSF, Mr. Richard Biarogaba, CEOs present, our esteemed members, the media present, all protocol observed. Ladies and gentlemen, you're very welcome for our third annual members meeting. Thank you for always honoring our invitation, and we are very, very happy and pleased to host you today. You have been told that 3 years ago, NSSF started the annual members meeting as an avenue for us to interact and to get your feedback I was sitting there and listening to the passionate feedback coming through. All this feedback has been taken by the fund and definitely is very, very viable to us. As has been the norm, we usually award the most compliant employers. And this is the lighter bit of the event, and we've come to that moment now. My role is very, very simple, just to explain to you the criteria that we usually use. And then after explaining the criteria, I'll just talk broadly about the categories of the awards that we have. Now, in regard to the selection criteria, it's focused on our compliance model. And you have seen the figures in regard to compliance and how we have improved. And because of this, we saw it fit to reward the people that are compliant. We usually look at employers who are very faithful in remitting the contributions for their members. And we also look at those who ensure that the contributions are up to date and that there's actually no arrears that hasn't been paid, as in there's no backlog that is pending. And so, basing on this criteria of compliance, we've looked at two categories. We have winners from the branches, and then we also have winners across the board. From the branches, our MD has told you we have 19 branches, so we have one winner per branch, and we are going to award them here today. We also have six overall winners in three categories, and that is gold, silver, and bronze. The 25 winners who will be announced here this morning have therefore undergone rigorous vetting and have even been audited by our own team, and they have met the selection criteria. Allow me to salute the directors, management, and staff of these organizations, drawn from all regions of the country, for their hard work, diligence, and commitment to remitting to NSSF their employees' contributions. Thank you so, so much. And allow me to also congratulate today's winners in advance, because we do not yet know them. We've not yet announced them to you, but we would like to congratulate them. Congratulations to today's winners for this outstanding performance. And possibly just to specifically say that this year we have also decided to recognize those whose performance have improved. You might have noticed that there were some winners recurring for the last 2 years, but this year we decided to look also at the next level. Who are these who have been making an effort to improve on their performance? And this year around, you're going to see some fresh faces that you didn't see last year. Otherwise, we wish you all a very pleasant day, and over now to Maurice to begin to announce the winners. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Barbara. All right, I hope you are as excited as I am, because we get to reward the branches for an awesome job. And we want to start with the branches before we come to the companies. So may I first of all now invite Geraldine, if you can come. You will hand over the first awards for the Kampala branches. All right, and please, work with us, members. We need to congratulate these guys for collecting this revenue for us, or these monies for us. Okay, Geraldine, if you could join me.
Welcome to the NSSF Best Employer Awards 2015. Every year, NSSF recognizes and awards the best employers across the country, those who fulfill their obligations to remit social security contributions for their employees. The best employers are those who pass our 360 degrees compliance test. That is, payment of contributions on time, payment of contributions in the right amounts, payment of contributions for all employees. In addition, this year, the following criteria was used to select the winners for the Best Employer Awards 2015. Employers must have been audited by the fund. Employers must have been found clean. They should not have any arrears. Employers must be up to date with their contributions. meaning that they must be compliant on contributions uploaded onto member statements to date.
I'm hoping that's a drum roll for our winners. We'll begin. City Branch, New Frontier Technology Limited. Congratulations, New Frontier. Clearly you were awarded before.
clearly, someone else is giving you the award, but for the picture, let me give you this.
Congratulations, New Frontier, all right? Okay, if we can have the second award so that we now hand it over properly. Okay. From the Bugolobi branch, Uganda Breweries Limited. To Buckley, and from Buckley is Victorious Education Services. Anyone from Victorious? Okay, I think we have no one from Victorious. We will quickly move to Lugazi, Uganda Christian University. Anyone from Uganda Christian University? Oh yes, there's someone here. Congratulations, Uganda Christian University. We move to Entebbe Rakai Head Health Science Program. Yes, we have them here. Congratulations. From Kawempe Infectious Disease Institute. Congratulations, Infectious Disease Institute. And from Tireka, Mango Tree Educational Services. Anyone from Mango Tree? All right, Geraldine, no one. Thank you very much, Geraldine. Please take your seat. I want to ask Patrick, come. Our CFO, Patrick, please do come and award the next category of winners from Ginger Mbale and Soroti. Busoga Forestry from Ginger. Congratulations. Congratulations, Busoga Forestry, for your job well done, okay, for your compliance. Tumbale Kokonjeru Primary School. Do we have anyone from Mbale? Okay, we'll move on to Mama Teresa Global in Soroti. From Soroti. Stay around, Patrick, because we have a few from the north, Lira, Gulu, and Arua. From Lira, St. Chizito Nursery and Primary School, congratulations.
Congratulations, St. Chizito. And from Gulu, St. Joseph's Carpentry. Anyone from Gulu? Okay, we will have these delivered. And from Arua, Arua Diocese Medical Center. Gulu is coming, I'm told. We have someone from Gulu? Yes, Gulu, please. First come, Gulu. Gulu first, don't worry. Please hold. Congratulations, St. Joseph's Carpentry. All right. Now, Arua, please come. Arua Diocese Medical Center. Congratulations. All right, may I ask Richard now? Richard Wabire, please come. For the Western Awards. Awards for Western Uganda. Richard. From Kabale, Chisizi Hospital. Anyone from Chisizi Hospital? Okay, we'll have this delivered. Let's move to Masaka, which is in Western, interesting. Chibale Community School. Job well done, Chibale Community School. We move to Mbarara, Mbarara Grants Office. Mbarara Grants Office. Okay, we don't have someone there. We will move to Masindi, Masindi Child Development Federation. We have the team from Barara. Yes, Barara Grants Office. Congratulations, Barara. All right, Masindi, yes. Congratulations, Masindi Child Development Federation. From Hoima, Colin Insert Tourism Sanaya. From Hoima, anyone? Yes, we have someone coming from Hoima. And finally, but not least, we'll be moving to Fort Portal. All right. Please come, Hoima. Yes. Congratulations. And finally, Fort Portal, Kida Hospital. Kida Hospital, Fort Portal. Kida Hospital. All right, thank you, Mr. Wabire, thank you so much. Okay, may I now invite the MD NSSF, Richard Berugaba, to award our bronze category winners. Ladies and gentlemen, our first runners up.
First runner up, bronze contributor category, Wagagari Limited.
Wagagai, congratulations. Ladies and gentlemen, we can do better, really. Our bronze category, first runners up. Wagagai at 63,915,600 shillings from Entebbe. Thank you so much. And our winner in the bronze category?
Best Employer, Bronze Category. Eskom Uganda Limited.
Eskom Uganda. Sitting at 85,335,155 shillings. And from Ginger, congratulations, Eskom. All right, Richard, thank you so much. Thank you. Now may I invite the Auditor General, John Mwanga, please come. As the most senior government official here, we want you to do the honors of awarding our silver category nominees or our companies, okay? And our first runners-up.
First runner-up, silver contributor category, International School of Uganda.
International School of Uganda, 178 million. Do we have someone, a representative from International School of Uganda? All right, we will have this delivered. Thank you very much. And our winner.
Best Employer, Silver Contributor Category, NWSC Kampala Office.
Our silver category winner, the National Water and Sewerage Corporation Kampala Office. 250 million Uganda shillings. National Water. Well done, National Water, well done, and congratulations to you. Thank you very much, Auditor General. All right, may I now request the Chairman of the Board to please come and award our gold category winners.
First runner-up, gold contributor category. Airtel Uganda Limited.
Airtel Uganda Limited at 353 million Uganda shillings. Ah, the human resource manager at Airtel Uganda. Photo moment for you, Airtel Uganda. Our first runners-up in the gold category. Thank you very much, Airtel, and congratulations. Our winners in the gold category this morning.
Best Employer, Gold Contributor Category. Niall Gore.
Nile Breweries sitting at a massive 447 million Uganda shillings are our gold category winners. Nile Breweries, please come. We have someone coming. Congratulations, Nile Breweries. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause for all our winners this morning. Alright, thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, we really have come to the end of our annual members meeting. As I mentioned earlier, all your questions and comments to us through our social media platforms, even SMS, you can write to us, Twitter handle at NSSFUG. Keep those questions coming, keep those comments coming. Use the hashtag NSSFAMM15, and then we'll continue getting back to you and give you the feedback you actually deserve as members. We also have members of the NSSF board and members of the NSSF management, senior management team who are here. If you have one or two questions with them, you can actually find them within this building or even outside as we leave. But before that, I need to just find out, how is our record? With the selfie, Richard selfie. Richard, have you checked the figures there? I want to see how badly we did, Richard. It doesn't look so bad. All right, I have 51. What do you have, Richard? Okay, if you still want me to mention this, we can do it in the next 30 seconds. We have brunch, of course, and there will be departure at leisure. So on behalf of NSSF, we want to thank you so much as members for being part of this third annual members meeting. The conversation continues. Download NSSF Go and also check on your e-statement. We are providing statements for you outside in the lobby, just in case you want to check your balance. Awesome. Our record, 77 retweets. Thank you so much. Clap for yourselves, for those of you who are here. I don't know how many selfies in Uganda have gotten 77 retweets in about 2 hours. So I want to thank ourselves for a job well done and the team at Blue Flamingo. All right. Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen and fellow members. Have a good afternoon.